mic that often, so can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's an honor to be here, and I want to thank Chris and Matt and Bob and everybody here at the Aaron at the school for having me. It's an honor to talk to the students. I've seen some really awesome work today. And I'll remember some of that work, which I think is something a tribute to what you're doing here and to your great teachers. You really gotta, you know, you may not think of it now, but later on you'll, you know, realize, you know, how great your teachers were, what they taught you. There's the short learning and the long learning. Some things you get right away, some things might happen 15 or 20 years ago. Speaking of 15 or 20 years ago, I just got back from a trip, so I threw things together, and I have just a bunch of things from my career and what I do and being a painter. Of course, me and Chris have been colleagues for quite a long time, and we share a lot of stories and things in the art world. What I did with this is I've included, bravely, I've included some of my student work. My student work, not my students I have as a teacher. And I like to do that just to kind of talk, you know, about development and thinking, not so much, you know, in that the fact that making sometimes paintings that aren't always that successful can maybe learn, lead to somewhere else. And that's basically, I guess, how I think of myself as an artist, is that I try to get into things that are going to lead to another place. Just kind of keep it thinking as the next step. So what I have here, I'll just try to explain what each thing as I go, and I might rifle through some images really fast. And if you have any questions, please just blurt it out to me, anything I'm not saying or any information I can give you or the conversation is appreciated. So what I'm starting with is the most recent from my recent show in Tokyo, a painting, and it's got some of the elements that I've worked with in throughout my career. And one big part of my career is collecting. Collecting became something as an extension to myself as an artist. If you come to my studio, you'll see that there's just stuff everywhere, and that's one thing I always like to mention, that is that, you know, of course I consider myself a painter. I'm really, you know, I'm out of the closet about that. You know, I'm a painter. I can say that in any kind of context of the art world. But I also think the extending yourself as an artist has more to do with just than sitting down at an easel. It's like getting your resource material, finding the things that you're engaged with, what your subjects might be, what your resources are. So this painting was kind of the main part of my show in Tokyo. This is called Ruckus. It's some of the I had a friend who kept using this term ruckus all the time for commotion going on. And part of the narrative, narratives, you know, can be organized, but also they can be this kind of tension between things. And also, I have to say that, you know, some of the work that I've made and I'll be up front, I know we have commercial artists in here and fine artists and blend, but, you know, some of the work that tends to be in the Tokyo gallery has a certain feel, and I can't totally explain, I'll try to explain it more later, but there's kind of more of a fun involved and kind of a mischievous sense. And scale change, there's a lot of formal things that I'm really interested in. I hope that I can express my interests in formal principles. Okay, so I'm gonna flash way back. Don't freak out, but this is my undergrad work, because I actually painted portraits I came out of a place. Not many people in here would understand this, but I came out of a place as an undergrad where I was taught by very serious, formal, abstract expressionists. So most of my work was abstract when I was in an undergrad. And then all of a sudden I said, I want to paint some portraits. Of course, back then, it got me into trouble. People weren't doing it, but I did a lot of portraits, and I was really interested in expressionism. So these were the kind of portraits I was doing. I'll just go really fast. And then I got out of school, and I'm just showing some other things, and I did some interiors of the place I lived. And then I moved to Chicago in a studio. Was young and didn't know what I was doing, and so I've added some of my influences in here, and so I started looking a lot at Cézanne, which I don't think ever, you know, you can never go wrong looking at Cézanne. And I was thinking, I don't have people to paint, so I was looking around, and you know, sometimes an artist, you don't know what the hell you're going to do. So, and I'll be honest, you know, that happens. So I was looking at some Cézannes, and I thought, I was working in Chicago, I was young and I was poor, and I decided, I don't know why I did this, it's the only time in my life I've done it strictly, and it's not some kind of like religious way of doing something, but I decided for like a year or a year and a half, I'm just going to draw. So I just did large, like 30 by 40 drawings, where I was just experimenting with this table I had for my grandmother and thinking of these Cézanne kind of moves of playing with perspective and formal arrangements. And this is when I started looking my pile of my collection and using those as subjects. And these were really just very formal, large drawings that I worked on for, you know, maybe each one like a week. And I did about, you know, 25 or 30 of these in that time, and started exhibiting them. And then I thought I had to go to grad school. I have to do something to extend what I'm doing. So I went to grad school and started at the Art Institute. Oh, and then another influence is I was looking a lot at Stuart Davis. And I just loved the way he refined things. Like, you know, saw his egg beater sketchbooks. And just this one's an Art Institute that I looked at ever since I was a kid, and I always loved it, and I love the strength of the form. Of course, here's like the most refined one, and I actually just came from the show in Washington, D.C., so I'm still reeling from it a little bit. So that came under. So I did, you know, these influences, these are some paintings I did as an undergrad, or I mean a graduate student, when I started to try and put some of these things into my paintings. You know, I don't know what the heck was going on with them, honestly. They got just kind of crazy where I was like going flat and rendered and flat and rendered but setting stuff still up in my studio. And then I started working with Jim Lutz at the SAIC, who became a really influence. And this is where I started, and we've talked about this, and I know many artists here are really interested in narrative. This is where I started getting like feeling like I could handle having more narrative in my work. So I started with doing some portraits with my objects of different classmates. And again, kind of like flattening. This guy wore this crazy shirt, and then I was thinking of Picasso when he made a flat shirt on the little boy painting. And he was a drawer, and he had big rolls of paper. And by the way, he had severed a finger on his hand. So that one hand that looks like that, it was because he didn't have a finger. And then these were classmates, so I started combining my collection with just having people sit for me. And, you know, pretty much exclusively working from observation, so doing a painting in one or two sittings. That's something I always think about, is like doing a painting in one or two sittings. And that's like, it's kind of like this thing of like a test as a painter, can I do that in one or two sittings and stick a little thing in your shirt? And then of course started doing some portraits just of the objects, and this started carrying me till the end of my grad school. Oh, here are these crazy things. See, this could be really a failed painting in a lot of ways, but I'm taking the risk of showing it to you because it's just, I was like in some kind of postmodern like malaise somehow. And this is that table that I was still kind of obsessed with. This little Humpty Dumpty became really important. This is one of the only paintings I still have, a lot of them from that period. And then I did some giant paintings, and this was actually based on, this abstraction was based on the proportion of my studio at SAIC, so those lines on the bottom are actually like perspective lines, and I just said, well, I'll abstract the space and put the table in. I'll get all this stuff in all at once and have fun. It was a huge painting, though. You can't really store huge paintings. And I'm showing I did these little studies at the same time, and these are little tiny one session studies. And then I guess part of the reason I show this, some of this old stuff, was because in grad school, I realized I did about 300 paintings during my time in grad school. I don't know if that, I'm not bragging about it, but the thing is, I was just so anxious after being out in the work world to just get my work going again. And I could work things out in these little paintings. And then, of course, at the end of my experience in grad school, I started working with Ray Yoshida, who was at the Art Institute, and he became really not only an influence but a really important friend and influence on my work and my life. So I'm just showing you some of his formal qualities, and he encouraged me to engage narrative, which I was getting more interested in. And this is just some of his collection that's at the Kohler Museum or the Kohler Center in Wisconsin. And part of why I'm showing this is I've also, just by chance, started to get more influenced by outsider art, which gave me the license to authenticate some things in my work, and then another kind of just the road that things took is Ray showed me a lot of 19th century American still life, which I had never seen in art history. I had no idea what it was, and especially John Petto. And of course, immediately I was totally blown away by seeing John Petto. And Chris knows that too. So. And this is one of his ones, this Poor Man's Store. I looked at this painting like a lot. And then he did these flat paintings. And there were a lot, many artists doing these. And the Dutch did these before. So this wasn't like brand new. But there was a kind of this kind of innocent, authentic way that the Americans were doing it that I became really interested in. And of course, this I think just really one of the great masterpieces of American art, the Parnett letter rack. He did, several of these. So these were the things that were kind of in my head. And then I started to do these tiny portraits of things that I collected. This is when I kind of came out of the closet about painting stuff in my studio. So these are one session small paintings. And again, I was into this one session deal. I had to finish it in one session. And they started piling up in my studio. So when it came to showing, I just showed them as a group of almost like an installation of these domestic objects. So this is right about when I'm getting out of school. I got the school part over. Oh, please, hold on. So then I kept doing these. I did more and more. Some of them went a little longer than one session, but still pretty automatic. And if they're all life size, and I was getting more into the idea of thinking about materiality, like the difference between something that's stainless steel and something that's aluminum. Of course, there's gajillions of examples, and then the happy guy, the happy pair, and the shoes. And then this was one of the shows they were in. And it was kind of interesting because then collectors, it was kind of funny when I showed these for several years and these groupings, different objects, they kind of like almost bought them like a store. Like there's the shelf with the shoes on it. That's a shelf with the shoes on it. There's the monkey. So now another big influence is Morandi, Giorgio Morandi, who of course, I don't think you could talk about still life without. And then I did, you know, went further and started putting groupings of objects together, you know, and doing lots of these paintings, showing them and selling them and getting collected, and then just doing more. Sometimes I think of compositions just in my own head of a painting with lots of stuff in it and paintings with less stuff in it. You know, it's like a closet of some sort. And then this is where I started going in more into narrative. This is called Disc Heads. It's toppled. Then I did the dollar thing. Of course, every artist has to paint a dollar at some more. This is called Come and Get It. This one's called Between a Happy Greater, or a Happy Nut and a Greater and a Happy Nut. That's what it's called. It's kind of a self-portrait. And then I continued to combine these, this is called Monkey in the Middle, my political statement. So I started combining these different things and just trying to investigate things more and more. This is a wine bottle, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. I was very poor, so I painted this painting thinking if I could take a vacation. So this is called Romantic Vacation. These are workers. But I, you know, I was collecting these things more and more, and then kind of getting into this idea of different diversity of these things and how they, like, how can they make these weird objects that are kind of racist. And, you know, this is, so I did a series of things that are called Manifest Destiny and the hot dog guy. And actually, I was in a show in England. I had a show there, and they wanted to put the hot dog on the poster, but the guy wouldn't lend it. This hot dog guy, with the lady with the veneers. So I did a bunch of these kind of things, and they were getting more and more narrative. And of course, another influence. I didn't do this one, but this is one thing that's always, you know, the Spanish still life was always important to me. And I always like to go back to the Spanish still life in terms of thinking, because of the just sheer formality. I'm a sucker for really formal stuff. You know, there was a time you guys are all too young to know this. You guys are too young to know this. But there was a time where being formal was kind of under attack. But I'm really very open about that. So I did these, and these are all really small paintings. I mean, and Chris knows. This was a series of what I called Identity Crisis. And this is a tiny painting, like a humoresque, anonymous. These were all called anonymous. I did, you know, and for a while I had all one title for like a bunch of paintings. This is called Sour. No, this is Sour with a question mark. And my mom owns this painting. She like told me how much she liked this painting. I have no idea why. I didn't think she'd want a frowning guy. This is called Mistaken Identity. And this was just what's called Pear. This is like getting more into these things with lots of stuff in it. So I just did big piles of books. I don't know why I just started. It's, you know, just a formal device. Oops. I don't know what happened here. Oh here we go. Here's one that was really a later one. I don't do a lot of huge paintings, but this was a huge painting that's really, 6 by 5 feet or something. And the funny thing about this stuff is I realized how antiquated it started getting. Like nobody, like you guys probably don't remember what a floppy disk is. This painting I did when I lived on North and Western, and there was a big gang corner. So this one was named after Home on the Range. And when I painted Home on the Range, I made sure that I got all the notes right, because I didn't want to fake the notes. I didn't want a musician to come up to my painting and say, oh, that's not right, you know. So I sat there and got all the notes right. And then there's this ethnicity chart that I used to have that's, you know, and then the big gun, which unfortunately still is like the happening today. This is, I found this, and this is a time when I started collecting more and more, and the Ray Yoshida was a, you know, we used to go to a lot of flea marketing together regularly, and I found this like Christian songbook that said songs everyone loves, and I thought to myself, does everyone love one song, or there's songs that everyone loves? So I thought I had to make up, and then I realized that there's like all these figures that look like they're singing, you know, that's like was an influence for a painting. And there's like Ray's little hula girl. This was called Waiting. There, you know, I have the Kennedy bust that I used for a while. And some people asked me about that, and I was like, well, that was, he was killed the year I was born. So my parents used to say all the time when I was growing up that we had a big family, and they remember, when they remember my birthday, they say, oh, that was the year Kennedy was born, or killed. You were born the year Kennedy was killed. So that's, this is called Backroom Deal. There's a guy, you know, there's something going on in the back room. This guy with the cowboy, that's actually a liquor bottle from Zimmerman's Liquors, which is fishy altogether, or was back in the day. This is a self-portrait. So I'm just putting some of these formal. I decided to include my head in the still life. I know we're talking about mirrors today a little bit. There's a Picasso back there. And there's a Dick and Jane. This is a Dick and Jane hanging from the wall. And these are little studies. What I've been on consistently in my career is done a lot of studies, so that's why in gouache and watercolor. A guy in Indonesia bought this painting. He said it was very American. This one's called Thug, Me and the Thug. Thug. This is called Diversity of Defeat, D-A-F-E-E-T. Mm-hmm. Then the flat paintings came. I did a lot of flat paintings and still do. Like, and I call flat paintings where I'm just hanging stuff on a flat plane. This one's called Hairstyles, the torso. What I really work is thematically, and that gives me some freedom. Some aren't showing up, but here we go. This is called So Long. More narrative paintings. This one's called Upwardly Mobile. And this is called The Ward. Somebody sent me this this nurse. Like, I take things into my collection that people give me, and I thought something crazy looked. I don't know if any of you've seen that. What's the one who flew the cuckoo's nest? And I painted this painting and realized it's about kind of insanity. But it was a formal device too. It's like I was trying this backlighting in my. By the way, everything I do is from observation. I don't use any other resources. This one's at UIC Hospital, and somebody said they saw it in the skin ward. I don't know. These are some more studies, some very small studies. This is couple. So when I was talking about formalness earlier, I actually, part of my impetus for this painting was this middle shape. I love this middle shape. I thought, wow, if these two guys touch, this middle shape will come off. I think that's enough to make a painting. These are some more studies. And this was for a theme show about butter. And it was actually a show, this is called Jack and Jill with Butter. I had another title earlier that I kind of edited. It was called Jill Serves Jack, and I didn't want to get in trouble. But it actually was on the news, because they did this show on the news, a little blurb at the end, and the guy was like saying, everything's made out of butter in the show. And I'm like, my painting's not made out of butter. And this was, I did a lot of theme shows. I don't know how it happened, but I was asked to do a painting for the ping pong championships in Chicago, like back in the 90s. This is called In Her Hand. This was for a show at Hyde Park Art Center. It was called, this is called Headless. It was called Altered Objects. I had no idea what to do until I did that single file. Oops, some aren't showing up, but that's okay. I'm self-editing. This is one of the few large paintings. This is called Cream. I did this painting of like kind of tragedies for a while. I don't know why I was doing it, but there are kind of tragic situations. This one's called Misstep. This was actually an Elvis doll. No commentary about Elvis. There's some small paintings of corks. These are all, I did a bunch of corks for bottles. There's these old like liquor bottles that have, that are corks. This one was actually at MCA. Then there was this time where I went through another period where I don't know what happened. I kind of started thinking about painting and like more meditative. I don't know how to explain it, but I started thinking like the stuff of painting, like cloths, the canvas. And I was like, well, what if it's a portrait, but it's just a thing on a piece of canvas, and then I'm going to paint the thing on the key piece of canvas. And this is a study for a bigger painting where I just did blank, hung up some blank canvases, which a couple then commissioned me to do more of these. Some people didn't know what I was doing because there were no toys in there, and I don't know. You know, they say in your career you shouldn't like just change. This is a study. These are little gouache studies, about 3 by 4 inches, and here's the finished painting. Then I got into this idea that I wanted to do paintings of paintings. I wanted to be an abstract painting, but I couldn't painter, but I couldn't do an abstract painting because I wasn't known for abstract painting. So I just did these abstract paintings. I said I'll do paintings of these abstract paintings. So I did that for a while, and these are again tiny study. Here's the finished one. Then I kind of got back into like my collection. This was another commission. This is a tiny gouache, and here's like the finished one. Oh no, that's a gouache for it. I don't have a photo of the finished one. I did these tiny, oops, gouaches. Some of these aren't coming out, but that's okay. Did another tiny gouache. So these are where I did the gouache, not always first, but then I do the finished painting, you know, larger painting. And then I do my edits, you know, once I get into the painting. This was a tiny gouache, here's the painting. Here's the gouache, here's the finished painting. So yeah, I mean, they're a little stark. This one's called Dilemma, you know, the blank canvas, the blank palettes. A little depressing, sorry, but it was kind of meditative, I guess. And then here's, you know, and then I do these, I've done several just kind of paintings in my studio. I know I've told you I like doing paintings of paintings. The more cloth things. A collector, there's kind of a prominent collector that I won't name that bought this painting. And for some reason, he called me later and he said, that painting that I bought didn't have a figure on it. It was blank. And he started arguing with me. And I was like, there's a face in that. I told you there was a face in that. Anyway, it was a very uncomfortable moment. Don't get into that position, whatever you do. This is like a little married couple. So these cloths went on for some years. This was the gouache, the little study. How many of you do studies? Do you do studies for your work? Yeah, some of you? I would highly, highly recommend it. Here's the little, this is a weird painting. I never did anything, although I had somebody owns this gouache, but I did the finished one. You know, I think when I did this painting, I started realizing that I needed a new prescription for my glasses because I couldn't see that lady's face anymore. And then here's the gouache, and this one, it's owned by a couple in DC. This one. So the toys, this is another flat one. The stuff pinned on the wall. This one was Arturo's. Arturo's was the place, local place near my house, taco place, and they had a great calendar. I thought I had to paint it. And a guy in Indonesia owns it. I have no idea what he's doing with it. This one was couples. I thought I'd do a couple one. Things hanging again on the wall. The wall is always a great place. This is the more recent flat one. It's called Pictures, What Are They? This was, I have this old, they used to make these old books about painting that had instructions and told, modernists were kind of crazy. I mean, they like had, so were like the 19th century people were kind of like almost countered by the crazy modernist stuff. Like everybody gets into this theory, and there were these books that, explained what paintings are supposed to be. So I had this piece of paper, so I pinned it to the wall and did a painting of it. But I also had this little guy that's saying, don't stare, you might be crazy too. And then I realized, when you're an observational painter, you're staring at this stuff for like hours and days and weeks. And like I'm like, that's kind of effed up. Normal people don't do that stuff. They don't stare at something for like weeks and months. And somehow that's become my life. This is a little study that I actually gouached for a kind of a major painting I did. I had a gouache painting and I decided one day, sometimes you do things out of frustration. I don't know what to think of this at all, but I just gouached the thing. I like put it under there and gouache just goes whoop right off the page. And this is the finished painting, which is about the time I started showing in Tokyo, and this was in my first show there. They really like the dancing pig. And then these are some more just studies. I do lots of studies. This was Yukon Cornelius. He's, again, real tiny thing. It gives me a way to blur his face out. I thought he was looking into like a puddle. And then this was getting closer to recent stuff. This is my show at Packer Gallery. I kind of got back into the narrative paintings again. This is Devil with the Beer. Devil having a beer. Somebody sent me this devil's head. I wouldn't normally paint that, but somehow I did. This painting is called Faust. I've always been a big opera fan. If you notice, there's something slightly theatrical when I set things up in a kind of a suggested story. And this is kind of loosely based on Faust, if you know the story, he sells his soul to the devil to be young, and then near the end, he recants and he just gets old again. So this is, I felt like this is kind of that moment, and this little, the contract is maybe up here. This painting is at Elmer's College. And this was like this is one of the larger paintings in recent years. This is called Dream Cabinet, and one thing I always looked at were these, there's this whole genre of still life, sub-genre of still life called Cabinets of Curiosity that a lot of Dutch did, and then there were offshoots of them, and this was really large, and the setups I do in my studio have all kinds of like places, state kind of staging areas. This Naga, somebody gave me this Naga, and then I researched the Naga. And this thing was actually used to sell furniture in the 60s and, 50s and 60s. And then in the ads, they had this thing and that said that he would be skinned to make the furniture. I was like, man, that's effed up, And then there was I found ads with the Naga with Johnny Carson and all this stuff. I'm like, so I mean, the Americana has always just been fascinating to me. Then I did this when my mentor and friend Ray Yoshida passed away. I did this homage to him, this painting. So, and it's weird because I talked to him about doing something in homage to him some years before, and he had lent me this. He was from Hawaii originally. He was a Hawaiian, but he lived in Chicago. But he lent me this hula girl. And he had this really strong voice, and he said, "Frank, you better give it back." And then I didn't have time to give it back. He passed away, so I thought it was appropriate. I put it in here, and this is one of his paintings, a postcard of one of his paintings. And he lent me this one. So the title is. He used to always say, and he said it to several people, but to me, he'd point to something you're painting and say, "Frank, why are you doing this?" And then And so that's the title, you know, so. And then I'm getting to the last couple of years of stuff that's, the second to last show I had at my Japanese gallery, we had talked, and I've always been open to thematic shows. Some artists will not be in thematic shows. They don't like that idea. I don't know, maybe I have a little commercial artist in me as well, where I like to kind of do things in that. So I talked to the gallery owner, and he had this idea of me doing this thematic show about this obscure Japanese sea monster called Melon Kong. And I thought, well, are there some action figures or something? This thing is so rare that it was, I looked at, you know, I had to do a lot of research. So the first thing I found was the stills from, it was a TV show in Japan that a certain generation of Japanese people know this show really well. And it was the first show with real special effects, you know, black and white show from like the 60s. So I found some stills and I did these tiny paintings. The stills were real blurry and I said, well, I'll just stick it to a wooden board and do a painting of it. So I did, or kind of like studies. Then here's his foot, the guy running. Thought that was kind of fun. And the board became kind of like eyes, I guess. So then I found I found some images of this thing. And I thought I'd do like a shroud to this thing. So I did a shroud. I painted this piece of canvas and then I hung it up and then did a painting of the piece of canvas. And then I found an actual image finally of a some kind of figurine of this monster online. So I printed it out and I only had the flat thing. So I decided I'll cut it out, put it on a stand and do a painting of it. So I did one painting like that. And then I thought I had the cutout of the thing and I'll do a painting of the cutout too. So those were paintings all in the show. And the cool thing is he also had a toy company remake an action figure for the show. So there were action figures included. I didn't really know that when I went there. And this was the last one I made for the show. This is a still of the monster. And this is called Melon Kong Cinema. And this was on the card for the show. There's a little guy laughing on TV. There's always somebody like putting out a fire in those things too. Then I was in a show that kind of was an offshoot of it, of monsters. It was a black and white show in California that I was asked to be in. And I did this guy. I got this guy. There was actually a guy I met at the toy company that hand paints these Japanese monsters. He sits in a corner all day and hand paints these things. I mean, these guys are really passionate about it. So he gave me this, and I thought, oh, I'll do some homage to him and do a painting. And then this group of paintings is just from the last couple years. I was talking to a friend about doing some superhero paintings, which, you know, any of us who are painters or fans of pop culture, And I'm thinking of combining it with some of my old themes, so I thought about doing these, I call them superhero potheads. And then I kind of thought they had some kind of affinity to the, you know, the Renaissance profile paintings, like, of people. This was Super Ero. And this is the one I did that's in a show that's traveling. It's called My Hero. It's a show that started in California. It'll be coming to, I think, Elmhurst Art Museum next year. And then this is Super Hero. So this is a Michael Jackson wig right here. And it was to this really weird mask. And of course, this is my old Barbie hair doll. It's all hanging in front of her face too. And these guys, I don't know where I found these guys, but I just thought, you know, I do the double entendre and like I play with that. And you know, painting hair is really, if you could, it, you know, it became really meditative to paint hair, you know. there's really no way, one way to paint hair. It's kind of an insane thing to do. And this isn't my last show in Japan. This is the wedding. And, you know, I'm full on back into my narrative kind of things. This guy is so sad. I don't know what's going on. And the bottom of him, I don't know where I found him, but it says, "Goodbye, cruel world." And I figure he's got to be getting married somehow. And all these skeptical people around him. This one is in the last show. This is called "Have a Steak" with a exclamation mark. This was kind of a joke to the gallery dealer because we've had a maybe 6 or 7 year relationship, and when he took me out for sushi, and when I had my first show there, the beautiful sushi, and I said, "When you come to Chicago, I'm gonna take you out." And before I finished, he said, "Scotch and steak." So then, like, I kid around with him. I said, "You're gonna have a steak," you know, because they don't have steaks. I mean, they have steaks in Japan, but they're very expensive. And here I am back to this painting that was in the show. I'm just gonna show a few of these. These are my latest work, as I'm doing these small gouaches of my studio at night with almost all the lights off. I've done about, I don't know, 30 of these. And they're just like, so here's my painting in the middle, and here's another painting, and it's, they're just tiny, and I've been trying to figure out how to paint dark and watercolor, which is not easy. If any of you try it, it's not easy. This one's real tiny, but I do studies. You're going to learn so much out of doing studies. And then I did a painting, an oil painting, of the evening studio. And then it brings me up to the latest painting. I have some paintings going in my studio, and this is one of them, which is just about finished. This is called Old Painter or the Oval Portrait, does anybody know the Oval Portrait by Edgar Allan Poe? It's this fantastic story. It's like kind of stunning. It's only maybe a couple pages. You're not going to lose much time reading it because it's maybe less than a couple of pages, maybe a couple pages. But the story simply is of some, and it doesn't even identify the character being male or female, but a character walks into an old castle, sees an oval portrait of a woman, and he starts concentrating on that portrait, and all of a sudden it switches to where the painter's painting the woman, and it's his wife. And he's painting his wife, like every day, for days and days and days, and faithfully the wife keeps sitting there and sitting there and sitting there, and he's more entranced and engrossed into his painting. And then one day, he turns around, he's like, "It's finished!" And he turns to her, and she collapses and dies. And then I should get the quote exactly, but then he exclaims this famous quote, is like, "My life has been art, and life is art," or something like that, and then that's it. And I included one of Ray Yoshida's brushes in here. So that's all I'm going to say. Thank you. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to talk about anything. I don't want to talk about politics, and I don't want to get anyone mad.
I like seeing the evolution and how important composition was in the evolution of your work. I don't know if you could talk a little bit more about that. It seems to be so fundamental, and it rings out throughout all of your work now. It's like your attention to that at the beginning.
Well, composition to me, composition and content kind of feel seamless somehow. I don't know. I mean, I've been teaching for 30 years now too, so I kind of like, you know, you talk about students' work, and then you go to your own studio, and I think in terms of working from life, composition really does generate from your touching things. I love that part, because I've had creative blocks. I've had times where I'm just pacing my studio. You know, I'm not content just being a painter. Like, I have to have something physical. I mean, painting's physical, but I have to be able to move some things around. So it helps me to, like, move stuff around in my studio to get my brain going. I hate to say this to you guys, but I don't know if I have much of an imagination. Like, I have to, like, use tactilely move things around to spark something. I think just juxtaposition is so important that it's vital. Like, I mean, I have a new painting that is so, I think it's slightly demented in some ways. Not demented, but it's like kind of sleazy. There's like some sleazy drunk figure. I mean, some of these things you find are really weird, you know? And he's like got some girl like this, like statuette. I mean, I don't know if it's like too much. Actually, there's a few paintings I haven't showed that are a little, because there's like kind of like pop culture, falling out of pop culture, like weird novelty stuff that's out there. But then I realized that the way I set it up, it was weird that so subconsciously there was a yellow over here, there was a yellow over there, there was a pink here and a pink here, and it was like perfect. Even though it was the characters, I was like, there was something kind of that just pulled that together. You know, and I remember you did these kind of like rococo-y colored paintings, or those ones with the soaps and stuff. I mean, not that I'm referencing your work at all, but it, you know, there was a palette that developed just by putting these things together, and like using a certain backdrop. Like I'll put a backdrop of a certain color, even if they're just different grays. You know, so that's I think that's part of it. And I do a lot of sketches. I do a lot of thumbnails. The sketchbook is invaluable to the artist, I really believe. I mean, I've done way more thumbnails than anything I could ever paint. And it's not like all the ideas are good. You know, not all the paintings are good. But it's like, you know, that's where the studies come in. Like, I think I would go insane if I didn't do studies. Like, I really think it's so important. I struggle more with the studies than the oil paintings. Like, the paintings, like rendering and all that stuff to me is just mechanical. But it's like trying to think of how an arrangement is, and like that thing about thinking about color, like dark, how to really paint it dark. Like in that one painting, like this one, you might not see it so much in this space here, but I worked on that dark like forever. I mean, you probably can't get it, the real feeling up there, but it's like all color. It's all this color layered on it. And I'm like, what the hell is dark? You know, I mean, that's what I think about. You know, I know these kind of nutty characters are all getting together, but if I just painted it solely based on that, I might lose interest. Like, I couldn't paint a painting solely just on the subject.
Can you go forward to your the next one? Bang. just the composition. It's a lovely thing, but composition is very good. One word.
Yeah, and it's about that big. It's like, I always like, I don't want to look at it so big there.
One thing you didn't mention, I just want to hear you hear your take. You didn't use the word kitsch, and I want to know what you think about in terms of how you define kitsch, whether you are.
That's actually a good question. I mean,
Well, you can move on.
No. I mean, I feel, you know, I don't know if it's, I don't know quite, you know, the context of defining kitsch in terms of if it's a judgmental thing, you know what I mean? No, I'm not saying you make it a judgmental, but I think if I'm like judging, it's a good question. I mean, I kind of got over that, I think, at a certain point. You know what, I guess my answer would be this, is I think, not calling it kitsch, but my exposure to outsider art, really, I think it really liberated me, in a sense, because I kind of feel like those people that are untrained artists, kind of an honesty, I don't think all their work's good all the time, but there's kind of an honesty of approaching an object and a subject. you know, and but that doesn't answer kitsch. I mean, it's hard to talk. I think it gets more complicated as I've gotten older because, you know, I look at politics and I think kitschy things are happening in politics, you know, and like the current, you know, I think.
You said you were going to go there.
I know.
Yeah. I mean, it's probably a crappy question, but
no, I think it's important. That's important when you're dealing with collecting Americana or pop culture stuff. It's inevitable. It's inevitable, and then you think about the implications of things, like those racial things or things, you know, like things that are blatantly like painted black that look just like some you know what I mean, or like a stereotype of a Asian person, or
you're using,
you know,
stereotypes, and you're using bad taste or particular taste or outmoded taste.
Yeah, it's true. It's true, and I think some people, I think at times my work has been kind of grouped in lowbrow stuff, because I think, I don't know how to say that necessarily, but I don't, yeah, well, maybe not, I don't know. That's a tough one. It's a tough one, but I think it's relevant. I think maybe I would like to think of myself as putting bridles on it, kind of like utilizing it, like saying, here it is, you know, this still exists, these things are here, you know. I mean, part of collecting, you know, and the age-old thing with the still life is having like the used object or the worn object or the thing that has been forgotten and trying to, you know, put it front and center again. So, and I think, I guess kitsch is useful too, of like playing in a narrative. It can really be useful in a narrative, I think. I mean, it's surprising when you look into this stuff. Like, I recently I'm thinking, well, I want to have more African-American dolls. And then I got online, and it's like, there's not a lot. Like, action figures. There's really not a lot. I'm like, what's going on here, you know? And not to say that I'm not judgmentally saying that. It's just like, I you know, for my material, for collecting, I want to, you know, have, you know, this certain ensemble that's available. But I'm going to think about that. I'm going to go to bed tonight thinking about that. I know.
How did you become an international artist? Like, everyone keeps saying you're an international artist, you do galleries in different locations. Like, when did you start?
You can have one international show and you're an international artist.
Perfect.
And I had my first show in Cambridge, England, when I was barely out of grad school. No, actually, I was a couple years out of grad school, and I don't want to be the guy giving advice to everybody, but I did make a lot of work. I just kept working, and I just somehow innately knew that being in my studio, making a lot of work, I believe it for all of you. If you're doing that, things will come, things will happen. And I had a guy that was from studying in Chicago, who was from England, and I lost touch with him. He went back to England, and he ended up being the curator at Cambridge. And he contacted me and said, I want to show your work. I was like, okay. And, you know, that happened. With my Japanese gallery, it was, again, it's, you know, I was, you know, it's getting out and doing things. I think you've got to get out and be there. I was showing at Packer, you know, and I had some work up in a group show, and Japanese gallerist was standing there. One of my former students said, hey, this guy's looking at your painting, go over there. I went over there and he said, and then literally this is how it happened. He said, whose painting is this? I said, it's mine. And he said, and I was a little older then. I was getting less shy about the business aspect of the art world. And, you know, when he said that, I said, well, why don't you come to my studio? I was just brazen, you know, like out there. And he said, well, you know, and this is what any gallery's going to say, well, I don't really have time, blah, blah, blah. I said, I'll pick you up. And he's like, well, okay, you know, and he looked at his, he said, okay. And then that's how it happened, you know. He came to my studio, he looked at everything, you know, it was, and then I, you know, I said, what am I going to do to bring him to dinner? you know, and it's like, he's in Chicago, I can't bring him for Japanese food, he'd be insulted, you know. So I brought him to have Mexican food, and he loved it, you know. Showed him how to take a shot of tequila, and that was it, you know. The deal was sealed. So, I mean, but you know, the thing is, if I that day, I literally remember thinking, why should I go? It's a group show. Why should you go to the gallery? It's, you know, they're just going to have my painting hanging up. It's not my solo show or whatever. But I, you know, made the effort, got up there, and, you know, so I don't know how, you know, I can't say it's a direct, it's really, I mean, you really, you know, I'm teaching a professional practices class to graduate students at my school right now. And it's challenging in a lot of ways because you can't give them any kind of false expectations of the art world because it's very fickle. And it can be really depressing at times or challenging. It's not easy. But the one thing is, you know, if you get out, get yourself, number one, make work and get yourself out there, things are going to happen. There's no way they can't happen. I believe that. It's like, it, you know. So anyway, does that answer your question? I mean,
it does. It's interesting how other people start off. So I was just really curious.
You could start off by making a lot of work and also get the people. This is a really important thing. I'm here a lot because I know Chris, and I know I've met these wonderful guys. I know teachers, your artists. But the thing is the people that are going to support you the most are those people that you're at school with, your artist friends, your colleagues. When I've gone through things, you know, the people that are going to put you in shows, do you know, all that kind of stuff are your, not the big curator, not the gallery person, it's going to be your the people you meet in school. I mean, the people I met at both my schools are people I can call anytime and say, I got this painting, I'm working on it, I don't know what to do, or, you know, that kind of thing. So I don't want to make it sound simplistic, but it really isn't like meeting some giant curator or meeting, like, you know, or I don't envy you guys though, because I honestly believe sending your stuff like out there on the internet somewhere, I think it's frightening. I believe there's giant filters that filter everything out. You know, if you can't meet a person, it's really, really tough. Like, if I sent my stuff to this guy in Japan online, I don't care if I was, like, showing at the Art Institute or something, it would have been bumped off.
What I saw repeated in so many of the paintings was the horizontal band, the highlight of the shelf itself. And for me, it seemed to function on a couple of levels. I think on a formalist level, it's creating this division of space vertically, but it's also becoming this sort of self-referential element to the act of arranging or the shelfness of the shelf. It would seem rather easy to get a wider shelf and to have that space run out and to sort of lose the highlight from that. It would become the front of the shelf and that sort of rather thinnish horizontal band. And so I'm just wondering how you come to see that, or what place that exists in your work.
You said it exactly. That was perfect. I mean, that's really it. The only thing I'd add to it is I'm talking about all my confessions and how I'm an unabashedly tied to the grid. Like, I'm a believer in the grid, you know. I believe I have a hard time with opposed to a Baroque composition, like, and maybe that was my relationship with Ray Yoshida, you know. It's like, you know, modernism, really, the grid is so important, you know. I feel safe with the grid. But I mean, Ray used to come in, and when you had a strong diagonal in a composition, he'd say, why is that there, you know. And we talk about it. We really would talk about it for a while. And it's, I think I know it sounds maybe really weird to some of you guys, but I have to justify when I use a strong diagonal in my paintings. I don't know why, but it's, you know, I call when I talk, you know, I go back to the modernist jargon, but I call when it's like got really big diagonals, like a Baroque composition, where things are kind of going that way and that way and that way. And I feel unsettled when I have to deal with that. But for other reasons too, like you were saying, I think there's a spatial thing, there's a narrative thing about being the line, and the stage, so to speak, you know, the staging area. And also, you know, not to go so much back to Ray, but Ray was like, he would, if something was cockeyed, he would like not let you forget it. That's cockeyed. We'd move on. That's cockeyed. We'd move on. That's cockeyed. You know? So, I mean, I kind of get that I love the the architecture of a painting. You know, I love the idea of like something being like just completely stable like that. Like, yeah, I would kind of go crazy if I had a line that went like that and I had to put the... Also, I think it's referential to the landscape a little bit and, you know, a rising line. But you said it very eloquently. That's exactly what I think. I have no disagreement with that. Another question or two? I'm an academic, I can talk.
So, for your thumbnail process, like, how many thumbnails do you go through to finally come like a composition you enjoy for a painting?
Oh, I probably go through more thumbnails that I don't use, and I probably don't actually come up with a thumbnail that actually becomes a painting. But I do a lot of thumbnails. You know, and I do thumbnails without ever maybe rendering anything. It's just like weird. This goes in that corner, it's this size, that goes in that corner, it's this size, that goes in that. You know, just to arrange the painting, you know, that kind of thing. But I don't think you can ever do enough prep on anything. I don't think you could ever work on a painting too long either. You know, this thing, you know, the thing, I didn't show some of them, but there were paintings that I worked the hell out of in grad school, and they were kind of bad, you know, even worse than some of the ones you saw. But they, you know, I work on them, but I learned so much from it. You're not going to learn anything about painting if you go, oh, I what is that expression? I'm overworking. You know, I really don't quite believe that. I don't think that's really possible. I don't think Vermeer would have said, I'm overworking it, or Rembrandt, you know. So I really believe, you know, but going back to that prep work, a lot of those studies I showed you, I'll do during the painting. So a lot of them, I'll actually sit down in front of my painting and I'll like work it out. And I'll do multiple ones. I didn't show, but I do, like for that one big one with the Naga, I did a bunch of them. And some of them are paintings on their own. You know, I could frame them, put them in the gallery and say that. Some I don't think are quite that finished, but I mean, water media, I respect so much, you know, because it's, and I think also as a painter, you should go back and forth. You really should like get your hands in a couple different ones. I think it's healthy, you know. Does that help?
Yeah, definitely.
But do as many as possible. Don't stop yourself. You can't do enough of it.